thank you all for being here tonight to listen to my talk on international space law. Outer space, the wild west of the universe. A seemingly lawless expanse that seems to stretch on forever. It has so many applications and so many countries use it. But how do we work out who can use outer space, who owns outer space, and what we can and can't do in outer space? Introducing space law, an area of law dedicated to governing space activities. Space is an international endeavour, accessed and used by many nations globally. So space law is often international law, operating at the United Nations level. It comprises of many, many international treaties, agreements and conventions, and hundreds upon thousands of pages of law. Outer space has been around for as long as the universe has existed. However, human application of space is fairly recent, speaking in the context of thousands of years of civilization. October 4th, 1957, was a massive day in space history, as Sputnik, the first artificial satellite, was launched by the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics during the Cold War. A giant space race was in project between the USSR and the United States of America, each country pushing to conquer space first. The main focus during this time was beating the other country, so the practicalities of getting to space came first. Space truly was lawless in this period. This was rectified shortly after in 1963 with a declaration of legal principles governing the activities of space in the exploration and use of outer space, followed by the 1966 Treaty on principles governing the activities of states in the exploration and use of outer space, including the moon and other celestial bodies, which is still in effect today. Being a casual 2,528 words long, the Outer Space Treaty, as it is colloquially known as, dictates how United Nations member states can use outer space. It includes articles detailing how outer space must be used peacefully, that nuclear weapons are not allowed in outer space, and how outer space belongs to everyone. However, the treaty and all United Nations publications regarding outer space since conveniently fail to define outer space. Pretty handy, right? Complications arise as, according to the 1944 Chicago Convention on International Civil Aviation, the air above a country belongs to that country. It is national airspace, and it is arguably important for countries to have sovereignty over their airspace to ensure the safety and security of its citizens, minimizing its threats from other countries and internal parties. However, there is no limit to a country's national airspace. Again, another forgotten definition. So a country would be within its rights to claim its airspace extends forever throughout the universe. However, this claim is unreasonable because at some point, national airspace must change into outer space, unable to be used for national appropriation. It would be safe to assume that there is a clear border between airspace and outer space, similar to a physical line between countries. Well, there isn't. In fact, there isn't even a clear, universally accepted definition of outer space, other than the statement, the physical universe beyond the Earth's atmosphere. In fact, the Cambridge Dictionary very specifically defines outer space as very far away from Earth. How far away is very far away? Where does the Earth's atmosphere end and outer space start? There are so many discrepancies in definitions of outer space between countries found in their own domestic legislation. You would be surprised to know just how much space law there is. Generally, outer space is defined somewhere between 80 to 100 kilometers above sea level, between the mesosphere and the thermosphere. Australia identifies outer space to begin at the Kármán line, at 100 kilometres above mean sea level, while the Federation Aeronautic International, the world governing body for human spaceflight and airsport, recognises the astronautic line between airspace and outer space at 80 kilometres altitude. Now you may be asking yourself, why does this matter? Olivia, surely it's not that big of an issue. Because the geopolitical situation at the moment totally doesn't encourage countries to find great zones to utilise for their benefit. Well, I'm sure you heard about the Chinese balloon sitting above the United States of America earlier this year. The US shot down the balloon, with Washington DC arguing that the balloon was sitting within its national airspace, as in accordance with the Chicago Convention. Beijing counter-argued that the United States had no right to shoot down the balloon as it sat in outer space, a domain accessible by all nations, as in accordance with the Outer Space Treaty, something that wasn't really reported in the Western media. In fact, Chinese Foreign Ministry spokesperson Wang Wenbin stated that, without the approval of relevant Chinese authorities, the United States of America has illegally flown at least 10 times over China's territorial airspace. It is evident that political relations have a substantial effect on international activities for national interest, with exploitation of space law going both ways. We must cut the United Nations a bit of slack for not providing definitions, though. Back in 1944 and 1966, for the upper limit of airspace and the lower limit of outer space. Planes in the 1940s were unpressurized and dangerous, flying at relatively low altitudes, while space exploration was rather unimaginable. Similarly, the Outer Space Treaty was perfectly adequate for its time, covering all pressing issues the United Nations anticipated space law would face. However, I believe it is fair to criticise the United Nations for not making significant updates to the Outer Space Treaty since 1966. Space technology and the space industry as a whole has advanced rapidly at unprecedented rates, leaving the treaty unsatisfactory in the 21st century. Why now, though? I ask you, why not now? While it will take time upfront and money and other resources to rework this treaty, space activities and near-space activities are an ongoing occurrence. International discrepancies will occur in the future if we let this grey zone continue to exist. We have already had a taste of this, and it will only be exacerbated in the future. And there is no risk to space exploration or scientific research, but it will limit the potential exploitation of a grey zone by countries. I cannot and will not comment on the politics of the definition or delimitation of outer space, as it is outside of my field. But I will say that the definition and delimitation of outer space will not be welcomed by some countries that may be using this grey zone for their national interests. Interestingly, in the 1960s, the USSR repeatedly proposed to define outer space at 100 or 110 kilometres to the United Nations Committee on Peaceful Uses of Outer Space, but the US rejected all definitions. There are obviously significant geopolitical aspects influencing international space law, with definition having the potential to limit the use of outer space for national interests for both Western and non-Western countries. However, I wholeheartedly believe that the benefits of establishing a definition and delimitation of outer space outweigh the disadvantages. Space should belong to humanity and hence be accessible to humanity. Additionally, it is extremely important for countries to be able to ensure their own national security. Space objects exploring and using outer space must be carried out for the benefit and in the interest of all countries, as defined in the 1966 Outer Space Treaty. Hence, space objects launched by nations around the world should not impose on other countries' national security, and hence must not be in their airspace. In this sense, the definition and delimitation of outer space would not impose upon peaceful exploration and use of outer space, and should limit the risk of countries to other nations' national security. I have spoken to space lawyers, space academics, delegates to the United Nations and space operation assessors at the Australian Space Agency. I have consulted professionals in the industry, sought varied perspectives, and attended space forums and talks. I have researched space law, read policies, learned about international law and its applications, and educated myself on this topic. All of the evidence I have collected leads me to conclude that changes should be made to international space law at the United Nations level. How can we make change? Well, change to United Nations treaties occur when a state party or member nation of the United Nations submits an amendment suggestion to the Secretary General of the United Nations, or the person in charge. This amendment must be accepted by the Secretary General and then taken to the Committee on Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. But as the average Australian, I can't just write to the Secretary General of the United Nations to implore him to define and delimitate outer space in the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs as being at a standard altitude across all nations. However, Australia's ambassador and permanent representative to the United Nations, the Honourable Mitch Fifield, has the power to communicate this suggested amendment on the behalf of all Australian people. It would provide necessary legal clarity and aid peaceful space use. I have discovered just how interesting space law is and how inconsistent it can be, with easily identifiable grey zones being particularly concerning. Outer space shouldn't be a lawless frontier, and we should know exactly where outer space is. Hence, I strongly believe that a definition and delimitation of outer space must be made in international space law. Thank you for listening.